Hey everybody, it's Mr. Jarvis. First and foremost, I hope everybody listening to this is doing okay. Unfortunately, it's looking like our year has kind of taken a drastic turn, but we're going to try and make the most of it. Now, I'm probably the last person who would like the idea of all of you guys sitting behind a computer screen in order to learn about history, but we're in the position we're in and we're going to try and make the most of it. So what I decided to do is take some of my PowerPoint and convert it to a YouTube video for you guys to kind of follow along with. And this first video is going to basically give you some context and background for the first five tasks that I had posted in Classroom. So what we're going to do is start off by talking a little bit about our sixth unit, and that's slavery and the path to civil war. In the unit, we're going to talk all about slavery in the United States and then kind of how it eventually led to a war between the North and the South, which is what we'll cover in Unit 7. I want to bring you back just for a little bit of context on the early history of slavery. So going all the way back to like Greek and Roman times, most slaves weren't slaves based on what race they were. Essentially, they became slaves either through war, being captured and taken prisoner, committing a crime in which their sentence was slavery, or having some sort of unpayable debt where they essentially needed to become an indentured servant in order to pay it off. And most of them worked in the homes of wealthier Romans, for example. One other thing to know is that slaves were really essential to the early movement of Christianity. And Christianity kind of promised them something that was really appealing to people in their situation, and that was like salvation. So like as crummy as their life might have been right then and there, they at least had the hope that in their afterlife they could go to heaven. And so a lot of slaves in the Roman Empire became Christians. When the Roman Empire eventually gets taken over by certain Germanic tribes around 467 AD, those Germanic tribes end up going and raiding a lot of Europe. And as they do, they take so many people who were known as Slavic people. And those are people who essentially speak one of the Slavic languages. Like today, it'd be like people in Bulgaria or Bosnia or Yugoslavia or Croatia. And you can kind of see on that map on the bottom right, they take so many of them prisoner that the word Slav, or as we say slave, just becomes like the generic term that people use for human property. So that's actually where the word slave comes from. Where slavery in the United States really starts is in the 1400s. And that's when the Portuguese, during the age of exploration, like the times of Christopher Columbus, they first arrive in Western Africa and begin exchanging products for slaves with kings and emperors of different regions in Western Africa. And that's really where we're going to start. As you can see here, this is a graphic of the Atlantic or the transatlantic slave trade, and this is probably stuff you've learned about in previous years. Basically, the way the Atlantic slave trade worked is that people in Europe would exchange manufactured goods or things that they had with kingdoms in Africa, and they would usually trade them for human beings that they could then send across the Atlantic Ocean, thus the name the Atlantic slave trade, over to what was known as the New World or the Western Hemisphere or the Americas, okay? And think like Christopher Columbus times. So essentially what most African rulers wanted were guns. And so they would exchange prisoners or slaves for guns, and then the slaves would be sent across the Middle Passage to, at first, the Caribbean, and then eventually to the American colonies. And what the American colonies had to offer back to Europe were like raw goods. So, for example, sugar, tobacco, cotton, things like that that would be sent back to Europe in order to enhance their manufacturing. I want you to take a second to write this down. Oh. So when it comes to the United States, slaves started arriving almost as soon as people from England began arriving in Jamestown in Virginia. So by 1619, England started sending slaves over to do some of the labor that was necessary for the new colony to be able to be successful. And throughout the 1600s and 1700s, you started to see millions of slaves come over to the American colonies. But for the most part, they worked in planting rice and tobacco. That's going to change eventually in 1793 once the cotton gin's invented. Because cotton's then going to become obviously the main cash crop of the United States, which is something we've already talked about with the Industrial Revolution. When the Constitution is written, actually slavery is actually on the decline in the American colonies and then eventually in the United States after the Revolutionary War. But in the Constitution, it does legitimize slavery by making slaves count as 3/5 of a person with the 3/5 compromise when it came to how many electors or representatives each state was going to get in the House. After the cotton gin's invented, obviously slavery becomes increasingly important. Now plantation owners are able to expand, and the demand for cotton, not only in the northern United States, but all over the world, essentially means that more and more cotton is going to have to be supplied. And that's where slavery starts to again increase in the United States. Now, in 1808, the importation of slaves actually becomes illegal, meaning we are no longer allowed to bring in slaves from outside of the United States. And this was all part of an agreement in the Constitution that the Congress would leave slavery alone for a time period of at least 20 years. And since the Constitution was originally written in 1787 and took 2 years to be ratified, that meant by 1808, Congress was actually allowed to make a law of this kind. So although we aren't necessarily allowed to import slaves into the United States, this really was not well enforced. All right. If slaves were coming into a port, let's say New Orleans, it was pretty easy for people who were running that port to be bribed into turning the other way when slaves were being brought in. In 1820, this is when we have the Missouri Compromise. And this is something that we've already talked about in class. And if you're compromised, essentially made Missouri a slave state and Maine a free state, but it also set the precedent that we were going to have a balance or an equal number of slave states and free states so that one side of the issue couldn't outvote the other when it came to voting in the Senate. It also set the precedent of that line that you see right below Missouri that going forward after 1820, all that territory that was north of that line, if they ever wanted to make states out of it, those states could not be slave states. They had to be free states. The states below that line could potentially become slave states. And obviously, as we know from our last unit, this would eventually lead to a war with Mexico, where we would acquire California and Utah and Nevada and Arizona and New Mexico. And then obviously, we had already acquired Texas, and that's what kind of led to the whole war with Mexico in the first place, right? You guys did an assignment on Nat Turner. Obviously, you know Nat Turner, if you did the assignment on Newsela, was a preacher in Southampton, Virginia, who kind of led slaves on a killing spree, killing 55 white people in that area of Virginia. And I'm not going to talk any more about that because you guys obviously just did the assignment on it. But 1831 essentially was a pivotal year when it came to the issue of slavery in the United States, not only because of, but also because in 1831, this is the first time that a newspaper ever uses the term Underground Railroad. And obviously, you guys know what the Underground Railroad was. It was a system of people who helped slaves escape from the South and into the North, and then eventually into Canada. And we're going to kind of talk about that a little bit throughout the unit. Okay. Just as a side note, I know you guys heard the J. Cole song in the background. I used to embed music all the time into my PowerPoint presentations. Until a couple years ago, it was 2 years ago, I downloaded a song for a PowerPoint I was doing on James Buchanan, and it gave my computer a virus. And at first, it really wasn't that big of a deal. I kept getting pop-ups for like different advertisements and stuff like that, like in class on the smart board as I was talking. But then I got a pop-up to meet Asian singles in Newington, and one of my students noticed it and started laughing. And I asked Jerry why he was laughing, and he just pointed to the board. And then I knew I probably needed to figure out a different way to incorporate music into my presentations. So I'm currently looking for a way to download audio files to just embed them into the slides. But for right now, we're going to have to do with the recordings that we have. So here you have the Underground Railroad. Now, the Underground Railroad obviously was a network of people who were trying to help slaves escape the South and into freedom in the North. Now, we're going to do a little assignment on the Underground Railroad for task number 3, but I do want you to notice 2 things. At the bottom of the screen, look down in Georgia and into Florida. One way that slaves would escape, especially in southern Georgia, where if they wanted to escape north using the Underground Railroad, it was particularly difficult. You would have to go through a number of states, and just the actual like physical terrain of trying to travel that far of a distance was incredibly difficult. So what a lot of them did was escape south. If you remember the assignment that we did on Andrew Jackson, an Indian removal, that tribe down there in Florida, the Seminoles, they would actually take in escaped slaves and allow them to become members of their tribe. The other route that a lot of people took, if you notice in Texas on the left, was south into Mexico. When we talked about the Mexican-American War, one of the reasons that Texas originally declared independence from Mexico was because Mexico had outlawed slavery in the late 1820s. Texas, having a large number of white settlers and a large number of slaves, essentially asked to run their own government. When they were told no, that's when the Texas Revolution started. And obviously they won. They became the Lone Star Republic. And then several times asked to be annexed by the United States until we eventually did in 1845. But just as a reference point, not all slaves use the Underground Railroad to escape north, and that's not a fact that a lot of people know. Some slaves did use it to escape south, either into Seminole territory in Florida or into Mexico. But for the most part, when you guys read about the Underground Railroad and do your activity, you're going to be learning about the routes that were taken going north into the northern states or into Canada. This is probably the most famous conductor of the Underground Railroad. You're also going to have an assignment on her, and this is Harriet Tubman. Okay, here's where I want you to stop. You guys are going to be doing 2 assignments based on the Underground Railroad. The first is task number 3, and that's going to be due Wednesday, April 1st. This is just a web quest that I have posted in Classroom on the Underground Railroad. Once you're finished with that, you can do task number 4. And basically, this is an argumentative response, so like a 1-page response on who deserves to be on the $20 bill. You're going to have 2 articles, one of them on Harriet Tubman and another on Andrew Jackson. You can use those articles as well as what you know about Andrew Jackson already in terms of his importance on presidential elections and all the things that he changed about that, as well as the Indian Removal Act, to kind of make a determination as to which one deserves to be on the $20 bill. Just for reference, Harriet Tubman was actually supposed to be put on the front of the $20 bill by the U.S. Treasury Department in 2020, this year, in order to celebrate the 100th anniversary of women getting the right to vote with the 19th Amendment. But that hasn't happened yet. And I'm kind of curious as to why. But I think with this assignment, you'll find out reasons why each one of those people deserve to be on the front of the $20 bill. All right, so by now you should have completed those 2 tasks, the one on the Underground Railroad and the other about Harriet Tubman. So before we get started on this part of the PowerPoint, I just want you to think about how those 2 things could have impacted the views of people in the North and the South regarding slavery. So you really see this divide start right around 1831, where the issue of slavery becomes increasingly important. And people become radicalized, meaning they really start to take sides on the issue. Now, people in the South are increasingly angry because they view slaves as property. Now, the Underground Railroad, they view as people in the North intervening in their economy in the South by helping their property escape their plantations. All right. Nat Turner, obviously, his actions are going to scare a lot of plantation owners who are very wealthy and influential in the South, because now they're wondering, okay, if this can happen on that plantation in Southampton, Virginia, could it happen on mine as well? So you're going to start to see, after the Nat Turner Rebellion, a lot of laws get passed in Southern states which don't allow, for example, slaves to be educated. Okay, they don't allow slaves to be taught how to read and write, because they fear that if they're taught how to read and write, they'll be able to pass material back and forth, either from slave to slave or plantation to plantation, in order to incite a riot or an uprising like Nat Turner's. And obviously in the Underground Railroad, people are angry that these conductors like Harriet Tubman are coming down to the South and stealing their slaves, who they find, you know, extremely valuable and hard to replace. Now, this all kind of leads to the beginning of the anti-slavery movement. And you start to hear the term like abolitionist. And all that means is somebody who wants to abolish or get rid of slavery. Now, people wanted to get rid of slavery even back when America was still the British colonies. But for the most part, from the time the Constitution was signed up until 1831, and again, 1831 is a pivotal year in slavery in the United States, the movement, the abolitionist movement, really is unorganized. Everybody kind of has different opinions. All these people who want to get rid of slavery, they have different opinions on how it should actually be done. So, for example, if you remember when we studied Thomas Jefferson, who at one point in time was the second largest slaveholder in Virginia, he would talk about the evils of slavery, but he would say things like, it's like holding a wolf by the ear. Meaning if you let it go, if you were to free the slaves, it could cause a lot of problems for the United States. He essentially didn't have a solution to the issue. And he, as well as many other people in the abolitionist movement, and I hate to call Thomas Jefferson an abolitionist, but they actually thought the best idea in order to help solve the issue of slavery was to start a colony back in Africa where you could send these newly freed slaves. Right, Thomas Jefferson didn't ever believe that he could have an integrated society in the United States, even though he kind of created an integrated society at his home in Monticello with Sally Hemings. But that's another story for another day. So as I was saying, a lot of people really thought that the best solution to help abolish slavery was to send freed slaves back to Africa. All right. And actually, by 1817, a colony is created, Liberia, for emancipated slaves. And a little fun fact right there, the capital of Liberia is Monrovia, named after President James Monroe. And Liberia is the only other country in the world other than the United States to have its capital named after a U.S. president. So in 1831, again, an important year, that's when this guy, William Lloyd Garrison, joins other people, other movements, and they form one unified group who's dedicated to the abolition of slavery, and it's called the American Anti-Slavery Society. By 1838, there's about 250,000 people who are part of this movement, with about 1,300 local chapters or groups, all right, that are all part of this bigger movement. Now, unfortunately, since we're not in class, we're not able to do the activity that I wanted to do with the anti-slavery movement, which basically had you guys as part of these local chapters trying to solve certain issues that eventually led to the demise of the American Anti-Slavery Society. However, we're not able to do that. So I'll just let you know that by about 1848, the American Anti-Slavery Society, unfortunately, ends up breaking off into different groups. And they break off into different groups for a number of reasons. Essentially, they disagree on certain key issues. For example, whether or not they should help support the women's rights movement, which we're going to talk about in a little bit. Certain people wanted to do that. Other people within the group wanted to maintain their focus on slavery. By 1848, when that group splits up, this is kind of what the United States looks like in terms of slave states and free states. And you guys are probably familiar with this from the Mexican-American War. By this point in time, the war has ended. And we've brought in the Utah Territory, New Mexico Territory, and then eventually California will become a state in 1850. And we'll talk a little bit about that with the Gold Rush. Texas, this is essentially what the map looks like by 1848. It looks like the map you see today. Mexican-American War. And in 1848, another very, very, very important thing happens in United States history, and this is the Seneca Falls Conference. I'll give everybody a minute to write this down. Okay. For those of you who don't know, Gwen Stefani actually used to be the lead singer of a rock band called No Doubt in the 1990s. She didn't just all of a sudden appear as a solo artist on voice. Anyway, 1848 again was a very important year in the United States because it really marked the beginning of the women's rights movement. And as I said before, the American Anti-Slavery Society did have a large number of women in it who actually wanted the group to also advocate for the rights of women all the way across the United States. They felt like their situation that they were in the 1840s was very similar to the situation that slaves were facing. Now, the most important figure in this movement was Elizabeth Cady Stanton. So she married the secretary of the American Anti-Slavery Society. And when they decided to go on their honeymoon, they decided to go to London for the World Anti-Slavery Convention. It's really romantic. So when she gets there, she's expecting that she's going to be like kind of an integral part of this convention. And she's actually told that she's not even given a seat and not allowed to speak. So she travels all the way from the United States to London in order to attend and speak at this convention. And because she's a woman, she's told she's not allowed to. Now, her, as well as other people like Lucretia Mott, they get this idea while they're there that they should have their own convention. And they decide to do this in 1848 in Seneca Falls, New York. And it actually makes a lot of sense. This is where Elizabeth Cady Stanton lives. In Seneca Falls, New York, really important stop on the Underground Railroad. And you can see it circled there. So it has a lot of abolitionists that are there and has a lot of female abolitionists. They essentially learned a lot of skills in terms of organizing big, large mass movements and conventions through the American Anti-Slavery Society. They knew how to articulate ideas about rights. They knew how to write to their local congressmen. They knew how to persuade them in order to try and advocate for laws that they wanted to get passed. And they knew how to get up in front of large crowds and be able to get people on the same page. So they decide to hold this convention in 1848 in Seneca Falls, New York. And they invite a lot of delegates, a few hundred to be exact, And this is where people like Susan B. Anthony and Frederick Douglass are seen in 1848. And they decide that they want to have, for the first time, an actual organized women's rights movement in the United States. Now, Elizabeth Cady Stanton decides that as part of this convention, they want to actually have a founding document. And they call this document the Declaration of the Rights of Sentiments. And essentially, it's modeled after the Declaration of Independence. And I've actually posted a copy of it on Classroom. And you can kind of read through it. And it reads like the Declaration of Independence. But whereas the Declaration of Independence was Thomas Jefferson's way of expressing all of the violations of the King of England and the way that he violated the rights of the American colonists, the Declaration of Sentiments was Elizabeth Cady Stanton's declaration of all the wrongdoings that men incurred on women in the United States. And they give a bunch of examples, like, for example, women not being allowed to vote, women not being allowed to have higher education because they were denied access to colleges. They're also denied access to the most profitable jobs at the time. Like medicine or the law. Women can't become doctors. They can't become lawyers. If they do work for wages, so for example, this is during the time of the Industrial Revolution. If they work for wages and they're married, their wages become the property of their husband. And this is among a number of other things that you can look up on that document that I posted. Here's where I want you to stop and do task number five. Task number five basically asks you to complete a guided reading. Chapter 14, Section 4, and I posted the textbook link right into Classroom in Task 5. When you're done, I want you guys to listen to this podcast from the Washington Post. The podcast is called Constitutional, and this particular episode is the one called Gender. All you have to do is follow the link that I posted and then click on the episode called Gender. And it talks all about Elizabeth Cady Stanton, Lucretia Mott, Susan B. Anthony, and all the influential figures in the women's rights movement. Also, if you want more information on Parchman Farms, from that slide on slavery and the Birda Birda song that J. Cole sampled, there's another episode on there called Fair Punishment, which talks about Parchman Farms in Mississippi. So if you like the way the podcast is done, it's done by Lillian Cunningham, who works for the Washington Post. If you like the way it's done, then listen to that other one too. It's definitely worth it. Okay, I'll get back to you with another PowerPoint. Don't worry. There'll be more PowerPoints coming. And hopefully they have embedded audio, not audio playing from my phone, but we're going to figure that out. And I'll have another one posted once April break is done. All right, guys, I hope everybody's well and it's good talking to you. Just email me or send me a remind message if you have any questions. All right, see you later.